Hello and welcome to Time Zone TV, where we have lots of special treats and a guest waiting to speak to us just for you. So here's what we've got lined up. We'll be joined in the studio by a very special guest who'll be revealed a little later. Also on the show, we have two live performances from the one and only Steve Lahan, who'll be performing his new singles. And finally, if you want to keep up to date with all the latest news so you don't have to go anywhere, don't forget, you can contact the show at www.timetunnel.com or you can tweet us at the usual method at Time Tunnel to get involved. Right then, let's kick off today's show with an old friend of the show, Mr. Steve Lahan. So without further ado, over to you, Steve.
I've got you under my skin. I've got you deep in the heart of me. So deep in my heart that you're really a part of me. I've got you under my skin. I tried so not to give in. I said to myself, this affair never will go so well. But why should I try to resist when, baby, I know so well? I've got you under my skin. I'd sacrifice anything come what might for the sake of having you near, in spite of a warning voice that comes in the night and repeats, repeats in my ear. Don't you know, little fool, you never can win. Use your mentality, wake up to reality. But each time that I do, just the thought of you makes me stop before I begin. 'Cause I've got you under my skin. Sacrifice anything, come what might, for the sake of having you near, in spite of a warning voice that comes in the night and repeats how it yells in my ear. Don't you know, little fool, you never can win. Why not use your mentality? Step up, wake up to reality. I've got you under my skin. Yes, I've got you under my skin.
Yeah, what a brilliant performance as ever, don't you think? Right. As we promised you, we'll be joined in the studio by our very special guest for the last 4 years has been taking voice acting to the very next level. To give you a little bit more information on our guest, we put together a short documentary telling you all you need to know about him.
On One Apology, let's find out and have a look at the nominations for Best Comedy TV Show.
The Simpsons.
The winner is The Simpsons.
In 1989, a television series called The Simpsons was launched. The show became an instant hit and was well received by a wide audience. However, one voice in particular has become a revolutionary over the course of the last 4 years. His voice acting has caught the ears of millions. His name is Dan Castellaneta. Dan Castellaneta was born on October 29, 1957, in Chicago, the United States of America. His last name, Castellaneta, is the actual name of the real Italian city. Castellaneta is famous for his ever-present role as the voice of Homer Simpson and other well-known characters such as Krusty the Clown and Grandpa Simpson. Despite voicing characters who led unhealthy lifestyles such as Homer Simpson and Barney, Dan Castellaneta leads a healthy lifestyle as he is a vegetarian and does not drink. Before becoming the recognised voice actor he is today, Castellaneta went on to Oak and River Forest High School. After graduating from high school, Castellaneta then went on to university before venturing into the world of work in Chicago's Second City. Castellaneta's normal voice is not recognisable to Homer's. To accomplish Homer's voice, Castellaneta has to lower his chin to his chest. Dan sees fit to stay in character during all recording sessions to give the right voice to Homer. And to make sure he gets it right, he uses a tactic of picturing the scene in his mind. Whilst Homer Simpson is easily recognised across the world, Castellaneta doesn't really have a problem in public because he's rarely recognised. When Castellaneta first attempted the voice of the famous Homer Simpson, it didn't go to plan. He originally tried to use a similar voice to that of Walter Matthau. However, because Castellaneta was unable to get enough power behind the voice, Castellaneta instead tried to find something a little easier to achieve. So he dropped the voice down and evolved it into a more flexible and amusing voice.
I sleep in a racing car, do you?
I sleep in a big bed with my wife.
Oh.
Castellaneta has also been part of the successful animated series Futurama and played the role of Robot Devil.
You can't just have your characters announce how they feel. That makes me feel angry.
As the voice of Homer Simpson, Castellaneta has won a lot of awards. So far, he has won 7 Primetime Emmy Awards and has been nominated for 3 times. Most of the awards were given for voicing Homer Simpson. The last award he won in August 1992 for Lisa's Pony.
Dan Castellaneta is Homer Simpson.
And it is an honor for me to say that Homer Simpson is drunk. So I don't know how long I can stand up. But no. I just want to say, yes, ma'am.
No, Homer. Something prepared.
Oh, yes, I prepared something.
With all his success behind him, Dan Castellaneta is sure to continue to make a big impact on the Simpsons episodes in the future, as well as any other programs and TV shows that he features in.
No! No! Ah!
And I had dudes with badges frisk me. Teach me how to swallow pride.
Okay, well, that's it on time. Welcome onto the show, the most famous, well, voice of all time, I would say, Homer Simpson. Das Castellaneta is here with us this morning. Well done, Dan. Right, Dan, where do we start with this? I mean, The Simpsons has been part and parcel of course, British television broadcasting now for 25 years. Well, how did it come about getting the voice for Homer Simpson? How did you prepare?
Well, there's a lot of different things, really. I used to listen to a lot of my dad's comedy shows that he used to watch and used to pick stuff up from them. But no, I don't know, I do quite a lot of different voices just on my own, just to pass the time when I'm bored, really. And then Homer just came out of nowhere.
I mean, the one big thing about it is you can walk down the street. I mean, you're not going to be using the Homer Simpson voice by going to McDonald's and ordering a bagel or whatever the case may be. But you were born in Chicago back in 1957, the Windy City. I mean, is that the thing you've always done? When did you realise you had a knack of doing voices?
Oh, it just, I don't know, it was like, probably in college, I started doing voices and just started making people laugh. So I was like, oh, it might be onto something. And then after a bit, a few of my friends got together and that, and then just used to make these little weird shows on our own. And after a bit, I just got this character of Homer Simpson, and all the stuff with The Simpsons just all crashed into one.
Are you actually surprised at the immense success of The Simpsons? Obviously, we're still going on 25, 26 years into it. I mean, a lot of people, I think, assumed it was just going to be a couple of years, 2 or 3 years, that was it, and then you'd have moved on. But, I mean, obviously, you've won quite a lot of awards. I mean, looking at your photograph there, you do look very similar to Homer there, so you take a lot of it. Is there a lot of you, Dan Castellaneta, in Homer Simpson?
A lot.
So is it about apart from you?
A lot. It's just like a silly, drunk, mongey version of me, but in a yellow cartoon.
Right. So what's the best thing about being a voiceover actor? What would you say? I mean, there's a lot of money to be made, isn't there?
Well, yeah, there's a lot of money to be made, but the difference between me and other famous people is they're not going to see my face as much as, like, say, Brad Pitt or something. So Brad Pitt gets mithered a lot. I know to people that probably seems like a good thing, but when you got loads of people trying to take pictures and stuff, you want to go to Tesco's for a cup of coffee, you know what I mean? It's just annoying. It's just nice having someone else's face to feel your fame.
I mean, it is very, it's very strange to actually watch up at any award ceremony, you know, use your normal voice like you are today. Then all of a sudden, you full swing into Homer Simpson. I mean, what's it like working with the other voiceover guys there? I mean, you know, these.
It's quite good, actually. You know, Bart Simpson's played by a woman.
Nancy, I know of Nancy,
So it's just great. Like, it feels like everyone's come from that same kind of background, because everyone's literally, they're not the same, but we've all got the exact same sense of humour. Like, we know how to work it, like, when we're writing scripts and stuff.
I mean, the one thing is, it's very strange, because when I first started watching The Simpsons, I was in my early 20s. It's still going on. Homer's still 31. I'm nearly 50. So it's very, very strange to actually see this family that I've grown up with in my early 20s. And I was actually just a little bit older than Bart in a respect. Now I'm as old as Homer. It's very, very strange.
We were thinking of making him older, but we were going to do a couple of series where they do get older and carry it on where they stay the same age from that series, from the end of that series.
I mean, I've got the longevity, but I mean, is there going to be a time where you think that Homer Simpson will, you know, hang up his duff beer for once and for all? And
oh, yeah, one day he will hang it up, but hopefully not for a long time.
You just mentioned it. Is that something that's in the pipeline? We could actually see Bart being morphed into Homer, dwarfed into his dad, Marge being an older version of herself. I mean, is there any plans in the pipeline to do that?
We've made a couple of episodes where, like, it goes back and forth from, like, the future to the past, and it's just, like, when they go see the gypsy lady and she looks inside a ball, and they start going into the future, like, what life would be like, and it doesn't turn out that very well. So we don't know how we'd work it if everyone was older, because we don't think it might be as funny.
I mean, the one good thing about The Simpsons is it's like an old show here, Morecambe and Wise, everyone wanted to be on it. You've got an awful lot of celebrities that want to be on there. We've had Mel Gibson on there, we've had Elton John, we've had Sting, and also you worked with the late Michael Jackson. I mean, what was that like, working with Michael Jackson on the show?
It was crazy. It's pretty upsetting now that he's died, but I don't know, when he was on the set, he's just such a big, like, he's such a big presence. It was just like Michael Jackson's it.
I mean, everybody worldwide is a Simpsons fan, so they all want to get on there, don't they?
Yeah.
Are there any guests that you'd like to work with in outer showbiz world? Is there any politicians? I think President Obama, the most powerful man in the world, he's been on it. I mean, so where do you go beyond that? I mean,
I don't know.
Different life forms, maybe? I don't know.
Well, we are thinking of space travel to go searching something. Not joking, but I'm not sure we have a Barack Obama, but I would like, I don't know, more comedy actors that I could work with, so just to bring more out the episode.
I mean, in your view, where does Homer Simpson stand as the all-time greats? I mean, in cartoon and animation, I mean, you've got so many weird and wonderful. You've got Pluto, you've got Mickey Mouse, you've got all these wonderful characters from the Disney stable that have been, you know, throwing their weight around for the past, well, century. Isn't it? Do you think he'll stand up in the test of time if The Simpsons does come to a close?
Yeah.
Do you think in 50 years' time people will say, yeah, it's Homer
Definitely.
Simpson, you know. Or do you think that'll still be going in 50 years?
I mean, might be still going in 50 years. Don't know if I'll still be around in 50 years, but
I mean, you don't just do Homer Simpson. You're also gone over to Futurama, which I think has been very loosely based on The Simpsons, and you're part of the robot devil. I mean, how difficult was it to sort of make a transition from Homer to the the devil in that?
Well, I know directors and producers quite well, so it wasn't too hard. He kind of told me what characters to like interpret into it. Like, it was a bit more high-pitched, a bit... I don't know, it was hard at first getting into the role, but as soon as, like, it just comes back to you. Like, it's like getting into the role of Homer. Just comes to you.
I mean, I bet it's hilarious when you're going through all the scripts, isn't it? I mean, how quickly do you get the scripts? How quickly do they have to be turned into the TV programme? What's the turnaround, would you say? A few weeks, a few days? What's the situation there when you're learning all your lines?
A few weeks, not many weeks off, to be honest.
All right.
But yeah, when we're getting together writing scripts, it is funny. It's great. I find it really fun because, I don't know, that's where it all gets made in pre-production. Like all the drawings and all the scripts get made before.
Well, it's absolutely amazing. I mean, you've got a big fan base here in the UK as well, as you can appreciate. I mean, The Simpsons. I mean, there's a heck of a lot of merchandise as well connected with that. I mean, do you get any of the, say, in the merchandise, or do you get anything there?
I get some clothing lines, some merchandise.
Okay, anyway, Dan, we'll be speaking to you hopefully a little later on. Very interesting to speak to you. Interesting stuff, as we said. We'll be back with Dan after this break and a quick news update, so don't go anywhere.
Time 4 News, and here are the main headlines today. The Conservative Party has been re-elected for the fourth time in a row, attracting a staggering 14 million votes in the general election. This is the highest number of votes that has ever been cast. Former polytechnics have reopened their doors to students as universities. Liverpool Polytechnics is now called John Moores University, and Manchester Polytechnics is now Metropolitan University. The change has doubled the number of universities available in the UK, and ends a spell of a 25 diversion of higher education of universities and polytechnics. Basketball giants LA Lakers retired Magic Johnson's number 32 shirt. Magic Johnson retired back in November 1992 after converting HIV. The number 32 shirt that Johnson wore in his playing time for LA Lakers has been retired in honour of the man who won five championships with the Lakers during the 1980s. Dan Castagna, the voice of Homer Simpson, has won an Emmy Award for Outstanding Voiceover the performance of his role of Homer Simpson in the episode Lisa's Pony. We'll now go live to the 44th Primetime Emmy Award ceremony in California.
Hello, I'm here outside the 44th annual film ceremony on a beautiful Californian evening. This has been a very successful night for everyone who's managed to be part of the ceremony tonight, especially for Dan Castellaneta, who's better known for the voice of Homer Simpson. The Simpsons have been a very successful hit over the last 4 years since its release. This award for Dan Castellaneta is proof the Simpsons are a success. Dan is one of two award winners from The Simpsons to win an award tonight, the other one being Nancy Cartwright, the voice of Bart Simpson. This is his first major award of this stature. The award was received for his performance as the famous dad of three kids in The Simpsons episode Lisa's Pony, which received approximately 2.7 million views in November 1991. After this triumph of Dan Castellaneta, it is very likely he will win more awards in the future as the popularity of The Simpsons continues to rise.
That's all we have time for today. Thanks for casting in, and back to you in the studio.
Yep, thanks for the news there, and hello and welcome back to today's show. I'm glad to say that we're still joined by our wonderful guest, Dan Castellaneta. Okay, Dan, we're going to ask you a few more questions, if that's okay. So where does Dan Castellaneta go from The Simpsons and Futurama? What is his next projects that he's got lined up?
I've got quite a few cartoons. I've got cartoons that I've just been making on my own.
Yeah, yeah.
But I'm not really, they're not proper produced ideas at the moment. I need to develop them a bit more. But thinking of a lot of different voices to do.
Do you have any favourite episodes? Anything that really stands out? I mean, you do a lot of Christmas specials and we're coming up to Christmas. So, I mean, how do you keep the show fresh? How do you keep people's interest?
I think, I'm not sure. I think my favourite show that I've done was probably the Halloween special. All the Halloween specials, I love doing all them. They're just so funny. The one where Peter's crazy, the one where we take the mick out of The Shining, Peter turns crazy.
That's probably my favourite ever episode that I've done.
I mean, Jack Nicholson's been on the show anyway. He's a living legend, as you know. Yeah, yeah. But again, you receive so many awards. I mean, are you getting used to it now? I mean, what was it like to get your first award for doing the voice of Homer there? That must have been payback, obviously.
Yeah, it was one of the best. It was the best feeling of life, I think, up to now. It's mental. Because it's just like, I didn't think how I've got to this point now in my life and how it all started. I'm really just not sure how it's happened.
I mean, do a lot of your family and friends, I mean, it must be annoying. You sat there having your Christmas dinner or Thanksgiving dinner, and do they say, go on, give us a bit of Homer? Does it ever get drain on you that you think, oh, no, please, Homer, we're putting him to bed for tonight. Yeah. We don't want any more of that, you know?
Well, all the time, my girlfriend always used to, she always used to ask me to do Homer's voice. I just could not be bothered. But now, I don't really, everyone's bored of it now. I kind of, carried on doing it so everyone would get tired of it.
I mean, what were your aspirations when you were growing up? I mean, you didn't sort of, obviously, at school and at high school, you didn't think, oh, I'm going to be a voiceover actor. I mean, were there any other things you were considering? Did you always want to work within media? And then, obviously, you fell upon this talent and you thought, hang on a minute, there's a lot of money to be made out of it. You can do voiceovers for TV ads, you can do it for cartoons especially. I mean, when did you really realise that you had this knack and this talent? Was it very early on, or were you...?
It was... I'm not sure. I think it was when I was in college, I could say, but I didn't really know what I was doing in life, to be honest. It's like it's all just panned out to if it's meant to happen. But I was doing art and design in school and went on to college to do it. So I was drawing, I like cartoons, so that's probably why I kind of did it. But then, I don't know, it all just shut off so fast. Feels like it's been about...
I know we are talking a heck of a lot about The Simpsons. I mean, obviously, your name's in the lights as soon as the credits roll, that's canon letter. But have you based Homer on any family member yourself? Was your father like Homer, or is it an uncle, or is it just a neighbour, or is it yourself? Based it on anybody specifically?
I think it's a mix of me and my granddad and how we used to gel with each other. So I always used to get drunk, but I didn't know what he was going on about, so it's kind of like I was a dumb one and he was the drunk one, so I've just mixed them into one kind of...
I mean, sometimes when you're at the award ceremonies, I mean, people are getting to know your face a little bit more. With social media, people can flick into things so quickly. But obviously, way back in the late 1980s, early 1990s, get a bit of miff that you thought, you know, you're going on this red carpet and people thinking, who's this fella, who's this, you know?
Exactly.
You're walking along the same carpet of all these Hollywood A-listers. But, you know, you are recognised a little bit more so now.
I mean,
you have been recognised in Chicago, your hometown there. I mean, what's the sort of public view of your own hometown where you're growing up and your family and friends? I mean, how do they perceive Homer and yourself?
I think my family and friends love me, to be honest. They're proud of me that I've got this far with just doing a voice, really. That's all I've... Well, it's not all I've done. I've worked really hard to learn scripts, help create scripts and draw, but...
Yeah. I mean, how long does it actually take to learn a script? I mean, The Simpsons, about 20 minutes, 17, 18, 19 minutes around that area. Well, how long does it generally take you to sort of turn around? Is the script?
Yeah, well, when I first started, it took about a day when I first started, but now I can read a script and it just... Yeah.
And the beauty of having a voiceover, it doesn't matter how old you get, because your voice pretty much stays the same. So, you started doing the voice of Homer when you were in your late 30s. Do you still see, again, you doing Homer when you're 78? I mean, you can probably still get away sounding pretty much the same as you did when you were 30.
Probably. Okay, that's what I mean. That's why I think we're going to go far with it. It's not going to end anytime soon. Yeah.
I mean, it's quite an ageless profession, isn't it, voiceover? I mean, have you ever thought about doing voiceovers for X Factor in America or award ceremonies at the Oscars? Have you been approached to do any voiceovers?
I've been asked to do a couple, actually.
Yeah.
But I don't know. Don't think it's my type of scene, to be honest. I do like being Homer.
But if you were offered the job of working at the next Oscars and best actress, you know, could you do all this business?
Yeah, I could do that. Definitely.
So you could do that. That'd be excellent. So, future storylines, anything you can give us, the British public, anything you can give away over the next few months? Any surprises, any more surreal guests, anything that you can...
Marge cheats on Homer.
Marge cheats on Homer? Who?
Can't say.
Can't say, so it's all under wraps at the moment, is it?
Episode.
Yeah. I mean... Would you say that most families in America do take to The Simpsons? I mean, there's an awful, rather than a real family, do you think they like this cartoon family? Do you think there are many dysfunctional families like The Simpsons living and breathing in America at the moment?
I think there are a few. You do hear about stories and stuff about people in America that aren't the proper family, not like doing the right things, but I don't think anyone could be as dysfunctional as like that family. It's just mental. Like, I mean, some of the stuff that you do.
There was a US TV series called Wait Till Your Father Gets Home way back in the 70s, and I have a feeling it was slightly based on those wacky characters back in the 1970s.
Well, yeah, there's a lot of TV shows that like where there is, it's like The Young Ones, that's an English TV show. It's just a bunch of wacky people in a house doing crazy things, you know, it just makes people laugh. And when you've got someone, a father figure.
Right. Anyway, Dan. Anyway, thanks. I'm very sorry we've got to have to do something, but all the success in the future of The Simpsons. Well done for bringing so much joy to everyone's faces here in the UK and the US. But thanks for joining us on Time Tunnel. Well, unfortunately, my friends, that's just about all we have time for. But before we say bon voyage, we're going to leave you with yet another performance from our old friend from the show, Mr. Steve Lahan. So join us again next time around on Time Tunnel TV. In the meantime, take in the dulcet tones of one Mr. Steve Lahan. Thank you.
I've got you under my skin. I've got you deep in the heart of me. So deep in my heart that you're really a part of me. I've got you under my skin. I tried so not to give in. I said to myself, this affair never will go so well. But why should I try to resist when, baby, I know so well I've got you under my skin. I'd sacrifice anything come what might for the sake of having you near, in spite of a warning voice that comes in the night and repeats, repeats in my ear. Don't you know, little fool, you never can win. Use your mentality, wake up to reality. But each time that I do, just the thought of you makes me stop before I begin. 'Cause I've got you under my skin. Sacrifice anything, come what might, for the sake of having you near, in spite of a warning voice that comes in the night and repeats how it yells in my ear. Don't you know, little fool, you never can win. Why not use your mentality? Step up, wake up to reality.